I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Have you ever realized that Christmas Day always seemed to feel different to Christmas Eve? And as I told the folks last night, Christmas Eve sometimes feel more Christmassy than Christmas Day. And I remember growing up when all the preparation for Christmas was done on Christmas Eve. The house was spruced up from top to bottom, inside and out. The smell of Christmas with ham and cake and coconut bread being baked. The Christmas tree was set up and the decorations were done. And all these things were done as we build up toward the moment of attending midnight mass, which was always nostalgic and magical. With the singing of carols and a packed congregation, the joy of the service, and the fact, as a child, we were out after midnight. And then on Christmas Day, we ate and slept because we were exhausted from all the work that was done the day before. And today, the majority of the people still attend Christmas services on Christmas Eve rather than on Christmas Day, which is why most churches have more services on the eve than on the day itself. And some folks like to have their major Christmas dinner on the eve instead of the day. And the gospel reading for Christmas Eve services often appears to be more exciting with lots of activities taking place surrounding the main event. Not to mention it is the most popular of all the Christmas stories. But on Christmas Day, Christmas morning, the events of the Christmas story in Luke's Gospel are replaced by what appears to be a quieter reading in John's Gospel. There are normally less persons attending Mass, and the atmosphere of the moment seems as if it has reached the crescendo of the season, which in a way it has. So Christmas Day always seems to be more quiet. And some persons cannot wait to throw out the Christmas trees the next day, forgetting that the real season of Christmas has only just started. It starts today. But while Luke's gospel reading focuses on things historical, the particulars of time and place and people, the names of the emperor and the governor when the birth took place, it focuses on Bethlehem and census registration, on Mary and Joseph and a stable and a manger, on swaddling cloths and angels coming to shepherds, and the shepherds' visit to Jesus and finding him in a manger as they were told. John's gospel tells us nothing about these things. He does not tell us anything of that sort. John bypasses all this information and tells us that God has come to us in human form to live among us. That God came in the flesh so that we know that he identifies with us. That the Word took on everything it means to be human being, to be a human being. So that we realize he knows all about us, our condition, our problems and difficulties, or burdens and frustrations, and all the other things that come from being human. God's Son took on full humanity to reveal God's grace and glory to his people so that God can be known more fully to us. And John takes us back to the creation story to remind us that Jesus was in the very beginning with the Father. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and without him, not one thing came into being. And what has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. And at the same time, John also makes the Christmas story like another creation story. So while Luke's gospel tells the Christmas story in a historical manner as to what took place, John's story is told in a more theological approach, focusing not only on Jesus himself, but allowing us to be a part of the story, placing us within the story, telling us in verses 12 and 13 that to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or of the will of the flesh, or of the will of man, but of God. And what he's saying here is that the Word of God not only comes among us, but the Word of God lives within us. It dwells within us, provided we allow it to, provided that we allow him to. And so John's gospel is different from the one of which Luke's gospel speaks. And note that although some may think that the Christmas story in John's gospel does not sound as good as the one in Luke, the comparison has nothing to do with either being good or bad, or better or bad. These two gospel readings of the Christmas story are simply different. John's Christmas story tells us the same truth as Luke's story, but it is told in different terms. But the one thing that both stories tell us, the same truth that is told in each story, is that God became a human being and dwelt among us. The Word was made flesh and lived among us. And so in John's Christmas story, there's no bustling activity, just silence, as the Word of God, the Eternal, takes on human bodily form for a moment of time on this earth. And this is why we are here, because God came to us with all our limitations and imperfections and frailties, so that we may have a true, meaningful, and lasting relationship with him, to make us one with him. The Word of God coming among us dwells in us and among us as one of us, which means we cannot escape the Word, no matter how much we try to avoid it, or ignore it, or deny it. It is here and there and everywhere. And our saying that it isn't doesn't make it go away. And yes, when Jesus speaks of the Word being in the beginning and the Word was with God and the Word was God, he is referring to Jesus. But if the Word came and dwell among us and within us, then what about us as children of God? What is expected of us? What does the Word becoming flesh and living within us look like? And my friend, the Word becoming flesh is meant to look like Jesus in us. The Word becoming flesh is meant to look like Jesus in us. We are meant to look and speak and act like Jesus. Jesus, the Word of God, is the pattern, the example of what the Word becoming flesh, the Word in human form, looks like. It is in Jesus being the model that we should be seeing ourselves and each other. For as God's children, we continue what Jesus has started, being the Word, becoming flesh, and living among us. We are all called to let God's Word live among us and to speak through us in our words and in our actions to others. And that's what Jesus came to do, and that's what we are also called to do, not only at Christmas, but all the time. We are to be sharing God's Word of love and compassion, hope and forgiveness, joy and peace, truth and grace and God's glory to a world that is waiting to hear the good news of what God offers. We are to share the gospel so that others know why we are Christians, why we belong to a faith community, why we have a relationship with God, and how important having such a relationship in our lives is. And they, in turn, will desire such a relationship in their lives as well. That they will truly sense, rarely feel the presence of God coming among us in their own lives. And so the Word becoming flesh in a manger is what we need to have in the forefront of our minds and in our hearts in a world that is very much in need of Him, in a world that needs light in the midst of darkness, in a world where many try to convince us that there is no God, and just in case there is a God, He must be absent from us based on all the terrible things we hear and see going on in the world. But the truth of the Word becoming flesh is that God loves us so much that He became one of us. The truth of the Word becoming human is that He wants us to live with Him forever, so He lived and died and rose from the dead for us. The truth of the Word becoming a human being shows forth God's grace and glory, making this all possible. As one of the best known and favorite hymns of Christmas puts it, "Yea, Lord, we greet Thee, born this happy morning. Jesus, to Thee be glory given, Word of the Father now in flesh appearing. O come, let us adore Him. O come, let us adore Him. O come, let us adore Him. Christ the Lord." Amen.